Hello everyone and welcome to another video. Now about a week ago I bought this OptiPlex from Amazon's renewed PC store. For less than £60 we got an i3-3240 processor, 8GB of RAM and a 250GB hard drive. Adding an entry level GT 1030 also meant that this thing could handle some light gaming. I had some concerns about upgrading it further due to the 240W power supply and lack of space inside this thing, but in today's one we're going to be making some changes to the system regardless and hoping that it doesn't explode. The obvious place to start is with the CPU. I picked up this second-hand i7-3770 for £62 at CEX. This aging 4-core 8-thread powerhouse is the best processor supported by this machine, and although it's showing its age in 2021, it'll prove a huge improvement over the i3. I also got a second stick of DDR3 to add to this machine as well, as 16GB of DDR3 in total and in combination with our new i7 will make this thing much snappier, especially for things like video editing. Upgrading these small form factor machines isn't too awkward, especially as the DVD drive and hard drive bay thing is of a screwless design. Taking this away gives us immediate access to the RAM slots, of which there are 4. I believe that 32GB of DDR3 is supported, but 16 is still what I'd call the sweet spot. This can always be upgraded later on if need be. Dell use a custom heatsink and fan combo inside these systems, most likely because of the compact nature of these builds. Now I'll admit I am a huge fan of OptiPlex systems, partly because they're so accessible and very reasonably priced on sites like eBay. Once the heatsink has been unscrewed, it lifts out in one piece. You might be able to tell that I had some trouble with the small cables here, as they are clipped in position very firmly, but we don't need to actually unplug any of them to access the CPU itself, nor do they get in the way if they remain plugged in. The i3 that's being replaced isn't worth too much money anymore, but we might be able to claw back a tenner or so by selling it, which will bring the overall cost of the system down. Every little bit helps after all. Always remember to clean off any old thermal paste and then replace it with some new stuff, because over time it dries out and could affect CPU temperatures. The processor will run a bit hotter inside this PC than it would do inside a standard custom computer though, because of the unique heatsink and the cramped conditions, so you might want to invest in better paste if you think that it will help keep temps lower. After making these initial changes, I hooked the PC up to my monitor using the internal graphics just to make sure that it worked, and much to my satisfaction, everything looked to be in order. If you have one of these with a third gen Intel chip inside, you shouldn't need to do any BIOS updates or anything like that before upgrading it, because it should just work straight away. With the processor upgraded and the amount of RAM doubled, it was time to squeeze in our new GPU. There are a few choices: a low profile 1050, a low profile 1050 Ti, or a low profile 1650. Given that the 2GB 1050 and 4GB 1650 low profile cards appear to be non-existent here in the UK, or way too expensive as far as the 1650 is concerned, I went with MSI's 4GB 1050 Ti, which comes with a low profile bracket inside the box, so in theory it should fit right into our OptiPlex. Furthermore, it uses no external power, so our 240W gold rated PSU shouldn't blow up, which is always a bonus as far as I'm concerned. The 1050 is a card that started to appear back in stock. I think it got re-released due to all the shortages, and this small form factor card is one that keeps reappearing. I would, however, recommend going with a 1650 low profile card if you can find one where you live, and if it's not of an unreasonable price, because that will offer better performance than the 1050 Ti. Firing up this machine again, this time with our graphics card crammed inside the chassis, reveals that everything is working as it should be, and our Dell OptiPlex 7010 has gone from a basic office machine to a budget gaming and editing system. Here is how the i7-3770 compares to a few other mostly quad-core chips according to Cinebench R20. And here is how the system handles itself in games. So for the gaming tests, I ran through a few titles here and I'm just going to be talking about them as I play them. The first one here is Call of Duty Black Ops Cold War. Let's just wipe him out there. Now I started off with 1080p, I wasn't sure what to expect, but this is with 100% resolution scaling. We are using the low settings mostly, but I always tend to use medium anti-aliasing simply because this helps eliminate some of those pesky jagged edges. Now I'm not too concerned with jagged edges in games, but in Call of Duty they are particularly noticeable, so I tend to stick the anti-aliasing setting at medium. As you can see, the CPU temperature is hovering around 60 to 70 degrees, although the CPU itself isn't really being utilized, at least not when compared to the 1050 Ti. This is definitely more of a GPU intensive title, and the game will happily perform well, providing you have a decent 4-core, 8-threaded chip. I'm glad we've got 16 gigs of RAM, because we are using almost 12 gigs with these settings. Here we are in the graphical options menu here. I'll just show you the settings that I'm using. As you can see, everything is set to its respective lowest settings, but the anti-aliasing was set to medium. That guy almost got the jump on me there. Now I was quite worried about Cyberpunk 2077 because I'm sure you know by now, but this is a pretty intensive title. Now it's both GPU and CPU intensive. It tends to work the graphics card harder in these more open sort of spaces, but as you make your way towards the city or busier areas, the CPU usage seems to ramp up, and I definitely advise CPUs with 6 or more cores, as even 4-core hyper-threaded chips will struggle. And as we make our way downtown here, you'll see the i7's usage start to ramp up towards 90-95%. You could see that once again the CPU temperature is absolutely fine, as well as the GPU temperature. We are just about getting 30 frames per second here, although there are some dips now to the mid and high 20s. What I'm actually going to do, I think, is jump into the settings menu and just see if we can change the resolution scaling option here. We're already at 90%. If we just put this down to 80, this might help out a little bit. I'm sort of surprised as well, though, that Cyberpunk is running with at least 30 FPS. It's a similar to base consoles experience, you know, Xbox One and PS4. You might actually be seeing slightly better performance than you would be on those two, but for the most part, things are running okay. Dropping that resolution scaling a little bit more has certainly helped a little bit, but now you can see that the i7, well, is starting to really be put under pressure, and so is the 1050 Ti. This is certainly one of the most demanding games to come out in recent months. Now you're probably wondering why I always show you this same bit of footage in days gone, and honestly the reason for that is because I do like this game, I really enjoy it, but most of the time I spend playing it on PlayStation 5. I'm still playing through it now, it's really, really long. I've been playing it whenever I can, anytime I've got a free couple of hours. Days Gone is my go-to game at the moment. On PC it runs really well, I think the optimization is pretty decent. If we jump into the settings before chasing this bloke down the hill here, medium we're running at this time. I thought I was on low, to be honest, but medium settings at 1080p with the 100% resolution scaling enabled. So yeah, as you can see, we're getting between 40 and 50 frames per second most of the time. The CPU really is being utilized here. This is quite a CPU intensive game. The temperature is getting up quite high as well. I think these i7s are good for 90, 100 degrees, so there's not really much to worry about here. Again, I'm glad that we do have 16 gigs of dual channel RAM in the system, because this game is using around 10 gigs, as you can see by the on-screen figures there. And once again, as expected, the 1050 Ti is pretty much maxing out. Let's just wipe these guys out here. The 1650, if you can find one, would certainly be a better choice, but at the moment it is pretty scarce and it's pretty expensive as well if you can find one, but that may differ depending on where you live. The VRAM usage of the 1050 Ti is also being fully utilized here. I do love this crossbow, I must admit. I always run around with a crossbow and it's certainly very effective. Now in this instance, Dirt 5 was actually more demanding than I thought. This tends to be a pretty easygoing game, pretty easygoing on certain hardware, but here it really put our 1050 Ti through its paces. As you can see, it's maxing out, as has been the case most of the time, but that VRAM usage is already at 4 gigs and we've only just really started the race. So I think with Dirt 5, it really likes a graphics card that has 6 or more gigabytes of VRAM, but we are still getting at least 30 frames per second, which is good enough. And considering that all of this is crammed inside of this once office machine that's actually staying pretty quiet throughout all of this, well, that's really not too bad. As you can see here, I'm racing my little Peugeot around this dirt track. The game doesn't look like a next-gen title, but it certainly performs like one in terms of how demanding it really can be, especially with this GPU. Now I'm going to jump into the settings here, and as you can see, we're running with the low preset, not ultra low, just low, but we are using 1920 by 1080, and it may be worth scaling this down a little bit. Now I noticed something quite peculiar with Fortnite. Usually this runs flawlessly, especially with quad-core 8-threaded CPUs, but as of the last update, it seems to be running quite poorly in terms of stutters. At least over the last few times that I've tested it with these sort of Sandy Bridge, Ivy Bridge CPUs. As you can see here, we are getting the odd frame spike with the i7 here. We are getting the odd sort of usage spike with the i7 here. At one moment it's running at about 50 to 60%, and then all of a sudden that will spike to 90%, and we will see a few stutters. I'm not sure if Fortnite these days is just more demanding and the performance mode is intended to be used with these CPUs, but it is certainly what I recommend using here, as we are seeing some performance issues. For the most part, the average frame rate is holding up okay, but the frame dips can be quite off-putting. I don't know if this is something that will change with the next update, but at the moment, the i7-3770 isn't really doing that well, and I certainly thought that it would be holding up better in this title, put it that way. But like I say, maybe this is something that will change, or maybe it's something that has changed already and it will remain quite demanding with these older CPUs. A fan favourite now and an absolute classic, this is Grand Theft Auto 5, which released years ago, but it still continues to be popular and it still continues to run absolutely fine. The i7-3770 is posing no problems for this game, or the other way around, that should be really. The CPU is also staying at a reasonable temperature. The GPU, the 1050 Ti, is also staying at a pretty good temperature. And overall, with all of the high settings selected, apart from, of course, MSAA, we are getting a pretty decent overall frame rate. Let's just wipe out a few more people here. And that was a bad move. Why on earth did I think that would be a good idea? Let's wait for the game to reload. It should reload somewhere in the city, so we could get an idea here of how the performance differs in busier built-up areas. As you can see here, 90 frames per second at the moment outside the hospital. This is probably going to drop to around 88 there. You know, it's running pretty well. Oops. GTA is still a pretty fun game and it runs quite well on a wide variety of hardware. It doesn't look the best anymore. I remember when this came out and the level of sort of graphic details were really quite stunning. And then when it got re-released for the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One as well, I thought nothing's going to top this game in terms of how it looks. But jumping into the settings, and as you can see, the sliders are all sort of dragged halfway up and everything else is set to high. Apart from grass quality, which is on normal. GTA 5 overall then, well, it runs fairly well on this old Dell, which is still sitting there pretty quietly. Finally then, it's Red Dead Redemption 2. Now my advice for this game, if you're unsure of how well it's going to run, is set everything to low apart from the texture quality. Always go with high or ultra texture quality, providing you have 4 gigs or more of VRAM, and then choose low with everything else, because that will mean that the game looks good, but it will run fairly well as well. As you can see, we are exceeding 30 frames per second, so you're getting a better than console experience here in terms of frame rate. Visually, it doesn't look quite as good, but it still holds up fairly well. As I was saying with GTA 5 just now, this game sort of does the opposite. This has me wondering whether or not it will ever be beaten in terms of visual quality. There are a couple of games out there, I'm sure, but in terms of overall scope and detail, well, this is going to be a hard one to beat. And I'm always surprised when it runs well on these older processors, but it doesn't generally tend to be CPU intensive. As you can see here, the texture quality is on high, everything else is on low. And as long as you've got four decent cores, Red Dead Redemption 2 will be happy. The geometry and grass sliders are about halfway here, just to sort of make things look a little bit better. Let's see if we can nick his wagon here. So overall, there we go. The Dell has been transformed from an office system into something that is capable of running games. How well it will hold up over the next few months, well, is anyone's guess, but I imagine that going with something like a 1650 would certainly, I hate the term, but future-proof it a little bit more. The CPU may also be of some concern, because 4 cores and 8 threads can struggle in some titles, but there we go. If you find one of these cheap Dells, it may be worth still swapping out the CPU, putting a graphics card in it, and just having an enjoyable experience. Overall then, thank you very much for watching. If you've enjoyed it, leave a like, leave a dislike if you didn't. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one. I think this little Dell PC might be my new office system. I really do like these computers.